This is David Dubal, and it's my absolute privilege to have with me one of the foremost pianists playing before the public. And I have never met her, and I am absolutely enchanted already talking about her favorite composer, Mozart. And we will be listening on this program to Mozart from her new Philips albums. Her name, and if you do not know it in the United States, you certainly will very shortly, not only through this program, but through her constant touring as a pianist. Her name, Mitsuko Uchida.
Well done.
You know, I'm not good at names, Mitsuko. Now that, again, I have just messed it up.
Mitsuko.
Yes. But I will get this after the program, I am sure.
After the end of the program, you see.
Of course. I don't do anything totally right. Well, you are in New York to play a performance of a Mozart concerto, but by the time this program is on, you will have played it.
Uh-huh.
And it is Mozart, and it's the concerto that is now so famous, K-467, right?
Yes.
Well, tell me how you became the pianist you are. Born in Tokyo.
Yes.
And of musical parents?
Not at all.
Mm-hmm.
But my parents both loved music, which is a rather rare case in the Japanese family,
mm-hmm.
I should have thought. Well, maybe I'm totally wrong, but I might be totally unjust about Japanese, but I sort of think the people don't necessarily love music. They take it as a sort of, as part of one's duty to love music.
Yes.
And it's something totally different, whether you love something, really, or you sort of take it as a virtue.
Yeah.
And music certainly has nothing to do with virtue, I think. But anyway, I think my parents sort of really loved it. And my house was full of old 78 records. And as a child, I sort of sang all kinds of little songs, I thought. And they turned out to be sort of the Lindenbaum out of the Winterreise or something like that.
Really?
And so I sort of grew up in German music. Especially songs, Lieder, very, very much so. And so as a child, I remember singing those songs. I never really loved so much piano music.
The piano music was not your first love. Then
no,
what
did
you want to sing? Were you frustrated you didn't have that gift?
No, I didn't know what it meant to be a professional singer.
Uh-huh.
For me, they were just people who sang very beautifully. But my voice was not there, but I could sing more or less, very badly, but I didn't care.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing that I did almost professionally was to play the piano. And actually, what I really wanted to do was to play the violin, and I was too shy to say so.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
And is this the reason you are now a great pianist, because you were too shy to ask for the violin?
Exactly. You might have been missing a great violinist.
Well, it takes so many lifetimes just to become a great pianist, let alone...
No, I'm not a great pianist.
You're not?
No. I'm just a piano player.
I see.
And I love it, you see. But don't ever say a great pianist.
You don't have any of these pompous feelings then about yourself. You don't walk around saying, I am a mighty artist, I am a great...
Who does?
I don't know.
Think anybody does.
I'm afraid they do.
No.
No, you don't think so?
No.
Then they deceive the world.
Yes, exactly.
Well, you have already opened up many topics, of course, one being duty and virtue.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, people are very fond of themselves when they're virtuous.
Yes.
And many people do think that music is a... something to cultivate.
It is not something to cultivate. It touches you. If it doesn't touch you, I think you can leave it. It's perfectly all right.
Mm-hmm.
Because you might not necessarily react to music.
Yes.
If so, well, it's perfectly fine.
Yes.
But the problem is, in today's world, that one wants to do things very quickly. And you want to be touched very quickly as well. Mm. You see, or you go to a museum, and you want to love it. And also music.
Yeah.
But it needs a lot of time.
Yes.
And time and peace of mind. And you must have, it is time.
Mm-hmm.
You can't be sort of doing something and then just sort of quickly listening to something and then adore it. I think that is so false.
Sure. people now have to get so much in, and there are so many things to listen to, so many recordings.
And also the TV, and it feeds you with all kinds of news, and I don't know what.
Do you watch it at all?
Not at all. I don't even own a TV.
Good. Well, it can only hinder you, of course. And too many people that even listen to this station are washing dishes while Ashkenazi is playing a Mozart concerto. Now, what does that have to do with music?
No, but that's perfectly all right. If you listen to something and you pick up something and you love it, and if you then take enough or make an effort to listen to it for yourself later,
I see.
It's fine. So it's perfectly all right for people to be washing their dishes or anything at the moment. But then after hearing something that is really beautiful, you ought to take the time and sit down and listen to it quietly.
But that is the hard part,
yes.
Especially in this society where we seem to have almost no time for anything, and yet we're supposed to have more leisure than any other people in the history of the world.
Yeah, that's true.
How come this has happened?
I don't know, because there is too much time. Mm-hmm. And you become greedy. And you want to be doing all kinds of things. And it is busier. Look, the other day I was thinking what difference it made about time and speed and distances. For example, when you talk about traveling from London to New York, well, you think about 7 hours, right? If you travel, Concord is 3.5. It took Mozart exactly 4 days when he had to rush from Munich to Vienna to see his ghastly archbishop, so Colorado. And it took him really 4 days from Munich to Vienna. You fly in an hour.
Sure.
You see? So all the things, you can do things much quicker. But if things can be done very much quicker, you expect other things to happen very quickly as well. And you want to be part of everything. And that you can't. So I reject a lot of things in life.
You reject them because you know you cannot possibly do them justice. Is that right?
Yeah, that as well as the fact that I want to have my time for the things that are important to me.
Yes.
I don't want to be doing everything, but instead I do some things more or less all right.
Yeah.
That's what I want to do.
Well, in the next months you will be practicing almost in solitary, in a way, in solitude, the 21 concertos of Mozart, which you'll be playing all of them in this 86 season.
In London.
This is a vast amount of music. I mean, something like, 70 movements or something. Did you learn this fast? Did you expect to learn it fast? Or is it something that is always in the process?
But it has been always in the process. Some pieces I did learn fast. Some I have been playing ever since I can remember. So it's a mixture. I mean, 595 I have probably been playing over 20 years. But 451 I have learned only in the last season, you see. So it depends. But all the 21 are somewhere up the sleeve, and I simply have to polish them.
That's wonderful. And when you polish them, do you expect a great deal from yourself that day? Do you also get trapped into feeling, because this is a monumental amount of music you're giving. It's not much 2 months.
No, it is very, very short. But although I've been playing a lot in the past few years, really an enormous amount of Mozart, certainly lots of concertos.
Yeah.
And so a lot of things are there somewhere in the back of my mind, but those are the dangerous ones, the ones that you think that you know. Those you really have to take up yet again, completely anew.
You are obviously a thinking human being about your art and about many things. Is it difficult to bring your conceptions to a stage in a hall often that's very big, and you may feel a lack of intimacy, especially with such an idiom?
But with Mozart, I find it. Beethoven, no. Beethoven you can play in a huge hall, and you can force the issue, you see. Beethoven does force.
Yes.
And you almost have to force. But Mozart, you can't.
Yes.
You have to let it take off. And if it does, actually, a too big a hall is a disadvantage for Mozart, mm. especially for the sonatas, for the solo works. You need a smaller hall, mm-hmm. and I want to have an intimate, small intimate place, and with the feeling that there are just a few friends sitting, me with my friends, and that's it. Concertos, they are slightly more outward going, mm-hmm. and you can even play a brilliant display of it. Now and then you can, mm-hmm. you see. There are, it depends on the piece. But the concertos can take even that. The sonatas, not at all.
Yes.
It is all towards, it goes in, towards mm-hmm. inside.
My guest on this program is Mitsuko Uchida. How did I do? Uchida.
Yes, that's it.
Okay, and it is really outlandish that I can't get it, but this is because of my friend Nancy Zanini, who is with Mitsuko. We're going to hear a slow movement. It's 9 minutes long. It's a sonata that is really not very well known, and it's from the sonata KV 533-494. Isn't that confusing? Say one or two words about this slow movement, and I want the audience to hear your art.
Uh-huh. Well, the entire sonata, well, the reason that it has got two K numbers is that because he has composed the last movement, Rondo Allegretto, mm-hmm. almost 2 years earlier. And the first and second movements, he composed the first two movements much later. And then sold it as a sonata,
he was just trying to earn a living.
Probably so.
Yeah.
But and people complain about the last movement. But I find the entire thing, although the last movement is slightly younger, mm-hmm. slightly less deep, but it is a wonderful piece. And the slow movement is one of the most introverted, most deeply tragic piece mm. that he has written. Well, almost like the B minor adagio, which, or the A minor rondo. Those are the most tragic movements that he had written.
Really? So I'm glad that we're opening with this kind of intimacy. It's the Andante movement from the F major sonata, and the artist, Mitsuko Uchida. Thank you. heard an amazing performance of a slow movement that is really quite unknown, an andante from the sonata in F major of Mozart, K533, the artist Mitsuko Uchida. And right after this message, we will talk more about Mitsuko Uchida's career and her ideas on Mozart and other things. Mitsuko Uchida is my guest. This is David Dubal. I was really startled at the technical control of that movement and, of course, of the pathos. It's a piece that is hardly famous, and I could understand how in a large hall with lots of coughing, the intimacy of that movement can really be ruined.
Yes, I can imagine that too. So, ideally speaking, Mozart piano sonatas, you play in a small room with just a few people, and you just share with them. Mm-hmm. That's an ideal setting. But, well, concert life isn't like that. But no. One thing that I noticed is that Mozart seems to suffer from being mixed with other composers. Beethoven doesn't. He gets through everything. He can put his foot down. Mozart, when you get something wrong afterwards, you have had it.
Yes.
And so, ideally speaking, you can play a program of, say, 20th century in the first half, and second half Mozart. Mm-hmm. That would be fine. Mm-hmm. But you should never start a concert with a Mozart sonata or something, and then continue with something else, and then finish with Chopin or something. By the time you have finished the concert, the great, great music of Mozart is lost. So, ideally speaking, you ought to play a complete Mozart piano sonata recitals in a small, tiny little hall with very, very few people in it.
Frankly, Mitsuko, I was thinking of you playing that movement while I was listening to this Philips recording, of you playing it for Mozart, and how delighted I think Mozart would have been.
Wow, well, I don't know.
Did you ever think of playing for him? Just
no,
the
I
idea.
Would be so scared. That is one thing that scares me completely. I would, and on the other hand, that's one person that I wished I could have heard. Mm-hmm. Mozart is the first one, because I can sort of imagine how Chopin might have played. Mm-hmm. That is a matter of imagination, but I sort of guess. Not that I can do it, but I can sort of imagine. And Beethoven, he must have gotten so worked up. And
unruly, so crazed,
and,
yes.
Yes, and banging Liszt. And everything. And most excited.
Yes. Then Liszt, we know he could break the pianos and so forth. But how did Mozart play? And how did he play on those pianos, you see?
But those pianos are wonderful. You know, I own one little square, 1790-91, mm-hmm. something like that, an English square piano, mm-hmm. which
a Broadwood?
No, it is called Longman and Broadridge.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. The sound has so much scope. It hasn't got the dynamic range. It doesn't play the fortissimo, loud sound. But you can still do, within the limited volume of sound quantity, mm-hmm. you can produce so much. So I've learned actually a lot out of playing those. But it is a recent thing. So when I played that performance, mm-hmm. I didn't know it at all.
That piano, you didn't know that piano?
No, I have. I got it only in the last 6 months or so.
Well, what's going to happen to you from now on? Are you going to do your Philips albums on this 1791 piano?
No, but in due course, I'd love to do something crazy without making any announcements. Maybe record the Chopin concertos on 1840s.
Pleyel
or Erard. Yeah. But the problem with Pleyel is they don't seem to last very long. Mm-hmm. I mean, they are not as sturdy or robust as Erard. And,
yes.
and I've seen several very, very good, most beautiful Erards. I might record it. And, you know, certainly my producer said, no, the people would complain about that bad piano sound.
Sure.
If you record on an old instrument, you've got to announce it. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I'll see.
You'll see.
I'll see. I mean, you can do things without telling people that you are doing it.
Yeah.
You see, for example, I'm using a rather extraordinary tuning on this record.
Really?
This piano sonata series. Mm. I'm not explaining what it is nor how it is, but nobody so far complained.
Wonderful. Well, you just keep getting away with whatever you want. I want to say this, that Philips, the label Philips, should be very proud to have you recording for them. Tell me how you got started recording for Philips and what your plans are with this great label and what you've done so far. Are all these discs also on CD?
They are all on CD. Well, it started with Mozart and Schubert. I think it was my producer, Eric Smith, who heard me play, or who heard a tape of mine playing Schubert sonata or something like that. And it's a G major sonata, which goes for ever and ever.
Sure.
It goes on
heavenly
and on.
Length.
Heavenly length, and it must be long. Mm-hmm. It's one of those. And he apparently gotten very interested, and then came and heard me play all the Mozart piano sonatas in the cycle that I did in London, and we were talking about maybe recording or not. And it was actually, I still remember it very clearly, when he made an offer. It was after one of my concerts in London. I had played a piano concerto, I think, at a festival or something like that. And we went to an Italian restaurant in Soho, and we ate, and it was very nice. And we were saying goodbye to each other, and Eric turned to me and said, "Ah, well, which Mozart sonatas do we do? What do you think of that, of the C major sonata, the late C major, the sonata facile?" I said, "I love it. I mean, my ideal program would be one side with sonata facile C major and A minor rondo, and then the F major, the one that we just heard, F533494. And he said, "Good, okay, that's a deal. That's going to be our first record." I said, "Are you kidding?" He said, "No."
How wonderful.
Yeah.
Wonderful introduction to your career as
yes,
a recording
actually,
artist.
Yes, it was quite crazy. Yeah. And I still thought that he might have been drunk or something, but he wasn't.
That was a fear of yours.
Yes, I thought. But I mean, if somebody tells you, "Well, let's record this at 1 a.m. in Soho on the street," I mean, you don't believe it.
Well, Mitsuko Uchida, who is my guest, is now going to play again for us from these Mozart albums. And I want to say that the one we heard, the Andante we heard, is on Philips 412122, because I know we'll have calls, so I want to help the audience now. I'm such a fine person. And we're going to hear now, if you don't mind, Mitsuko, I'd love to hear the last movement from another Philips disc, 412123, the last movement, that virtuosic movement of the sonata in F major 332, which is more famous than the sonata in F major that we heard you begin with. Are you ready?
Yes.
The artist, Mitsuko Uchida. Thank you. What a delight. Mozart is always amazing. In some movie, the hero said, "Mozart's enough for me." Mm-hmm. And he listened throughout the movie constantly to Mozart. He was obsessed. You just heard the last movement of the celebrated F major sonata, K332, on a pretty new Philips digital release. The artist, and indeed that's the word for such playing, Mitsuko Uchida. And right after this message, more of her playing. We will hear the most famous Mozart sonata. And so many people try to play this one, right?
Exactly. I've heard it really many, many times.
We'll be right back. It's a great pleasure to have as my guest Mitsuko Uchida. Am I getting it better?
You're
the name?
Getting better every minute.
Well, it's because of your playing. I'm really now concentrating on you. We heard from the famous F major sonata, and we're going to hear a piece that for some reason got tagged as an easy sonata. A
yes.
late work of Mozart, K5, what, 4-5, mm-hmm. I think?
5-4-5, yeah.
And I don't know, it has this reputation that every six-year-old can play it perfectly.
Yes, and somehow or other, you manage it, you see. Mm-hmm. But to me, this piece is almost a personal joke of Mozart's. On surface, it's very, very easy, but it is one of the most concentrated pieces that
Isn't
he had
it?
Written.
Yeah.
I think so. And to me, if anybody would ask me, choose one Mozart sonata, I would have difficulty choosing between this one and possibly that 533, that F major, mm-hmm. and possibly the last D major. Mm-hmm. Possibly, oh well, no.
And you go on and on, and soon the C minor and the A minor.
Certainly,
and the
yes. But C minor and A minor are so special. They go into a totally different category.
Yes.
They are with the D minor concerto and C minor. The minor pieces, by minor first movements, when Mozart writes them, they are so different. Mm-hmm. You can't say that it's better or worse or this or that. They are simply so totally different. Mm-hmm. So you put the C minor sonata and A minor sonata into totally different box.
Yes.
But if you left the rest, probably one of the first ones that I would pick would be the C major.
The C major. Mm-hmm. And back in Tokyo when you were a little child, was mm-hmm. this the piece that you were, Mozart became your idol?
No. Mm-hmm. The one that I remember very clearly is Das Veilchen, sung by a lady called Onegin. She had gloriously beautiful voice. She sang totally free. I mean, you would. I mean, it's a pity that I haven't got a record now that I could play it for you to show how incredibly free people sang Lieder in those days. It must be a recording of 1930s. Mm. Wonderful, beautiful. Tempo changes all over the place and this and that. I mean, but it was so beautiful. That is my first taste of Mozart.
What did your parents say when they saw you in ecstasy listening to this music on 78?
They didn't think much of it because we were three children. We all listened to it. Mm-hmm. So they thought, oh, well, there they are. They like it, so let them. that must be their attitude.
They never pushed you into practicing and so forth.
They told me to practice because despite their being very intelligent and rather extraordinary people, they also are a Japanese parent. Mm-hmm. And they thought it was a good thing to for the children to play the piano, and they thought it was good for the children to practice as well. And I was told by my teacher that that one ought to practice, let's say, when I was 7 or 8 or so, at least an hour every day. And certainly I didn't. Mm-hmm. But for a child to practice an hour, you must know exactly why you are doing it for. And when you are being told you practice an hour, that's not good enough, you see. Mm-hmm. And if I would have been told, well, you can do whatever you like in that hour, or 2 hours or 3 hours or anything, possibly I might have spent more time. But for those few things that I had to prepare for the next lesson, I couldn't spend an hour, so I didn't. But so my mother was worried, and she would ask me whether I had practiced, and I would say, oh, yes, yes. And so that's the way you learn to lie.
Of course. Practicing can be medicine. Think of the word practicing.
But actually, I love practicing these days, depending on what you do. But I love playing.
Playing is a good word.
Playing is really, really what one loves. I mean, certainly, I mean, you look at music, you read music, and you think it is marvelous.
A person is absolutely happiest when playing.
Exactly. I think so, too. You listen to it, and music is wonderful. But even if you play badly, when you are playing, it's bliss.
One question about Mozart before we hear your performance of the C major sonata, and that is, are you irritated with this almost cult of Mozart's personality? He's in plays, he's in movies, people are discussing him. Mm. They're saying, I am so sick of Mozart. I'm so upset that Mozart is treated as a buffoon. Another one says, this is the way Mozart was. Mozart has become a worldwide topic.
Yeah, but I don't mind. Mm-hmm. I don't mind whatever is fashion. Mm-hmm. As long as I don't get drawn into it. Mm-hmm. And if it is just a fashion, it would go. And only the truth would remain. Mm-hmm. That's what I always believed in. So it should be all right. In 10 years' time or so, people won't think too much of that play or the film. And people would simply listen to his music.
As they always have and always will, and now your recordings are part of that heritage. We're going to hear Mitsuko Uchida in her Phillips recording of the C major sonata K545 Allegro, Andante and Rondo. Thank you. the artist Mitsuko Uchida in a performance of the C major Mozart Sonata, K545. And that was, well, so many things. It was adorable. It was expressive. It had humor. It had pathos. And you call it, in a way, Mozart's most characteristic sonata, and certainly the one that people do a lot of harm to.
Yes, but it is so concentrated. It is so wonderful and so simple at the same time.
I want to tell you that I have had a wonderful time talking to you and listening to your recordings for the first time, and I hope to see you soon when we are going to do more programs. I know that our audience can hear you in New York in April of 1986 in the great Mozart K595 concerto. Mm-hmm. It's been wonderful seeing you, and thanks for coming to WNCN.
It was my pleasure, David.
This is David Dubal. Thank you for listening.